All right. Chapter 8, make every day a Wednesday when your thoughts become your bully. Whatever you think about, you'll bring about. This is probably the most single-handedly important topic in the life of a leader. If you get this chapter, you'll move from the brink of breakthrough to the driveway of dreams. Close and closer are different because of the letter R. Your success will be dependent upon the degree of your understanding of the topic of dominant desire. I'm going to make 5 power statements about dominant thought, and then I'm going to do my best to unpack them with a story. Here they are. Number 1, you are headed in the direction of your most dominant thought. Number 2, your dominant thought should disturb your current default settings. Number 3, your dominant thought determines the detailed directions, daily decisions, and your final destination. 4, you must acquire and keep a fire around your dominant thought. And 5, your dominant thought will dominate your life. Each year for the last 9 years, my wife and I have been on a cruise for one of our vacations. It is our preferred way of travel. So much to do, many things to see, with our favorite being to people watch. Since you're not going to catch us in the pool, nor can I handle any more sun, we order the drink of the day and find a place of shade to relax and watch people. It's a sight to see. We talk back and forth in code because one of us can't whisper and the other can't hear. Most of our conversation revolves around what people decided to bring on vacation. I often think to myself, I know for sure they had something else they could have packed in their suitcase. People are bold. The skinny, thick, or plus-size individual can all be seen in something they should have kept back home. Well, that's my opinion. And they didn't ask me, nor did I pay for their vacation, so I guess I should do me and allow them to do what they do. Oh, for the record, they are doing just that. I tell this story because it illustrates our thought life. When one goes on vacation, they must pick out from all their clothes a few select items that they are going to pack and wear while on vacation. You can't take everything you own. You must choose which ones will go with you. When it comes to your dominant thought, the first thing you must know and own is you have the power of choosing your dominant thought. The choice is yours, not the people watchers who don't know your name, didn't pay your fare, nor really care about what you have on. Their comments shouldn't be of concern to you. I must instate a familiar buttism. You will build what you birth and you will drop what you adopt. This dominant thought begins within, not without. In a society that social media influences so greatly, we find ourselves attempting at times to create a life that is measured by a standard of stuff that's just not real. You must shut off and silence the noise in order to become aware of who you are and what's important to you. The second point I notice is there are more clothes left at home than you bring on vacation, which means the other thoughts of your life can be left as well. Is there a difference between your vacation thoughts and your home thoughts? When it comes to my dominant thoughts, most people's dreams and goals are like vacation wear. We only visit them every so often. They bring us joy. We know what they are, and we travel there with them from time to time. The reality of life is we live more often than not thinking about our general day-to-day thoughts versus allowing our dreams and goals to become our dominant thoughts. If we could find a way to reverse this order, I believe we would begin to see life change right before our eyes. I must add another buttism right here. Insanity and destiny don't go together. Let that sit in as we turn the corner and learn how to change, exchange, and rearrange our thought life. We must first change our thoughts. We must begin to think about what we're thinking about. This is work. It sounds easier than it is. This is a skill set that you will grow in. And the better you become, the greater the clarity and focus you will possess. Allow me to get tactical and practical. Let's look at the steps I took in order to develop this necessary skill in my life. Here goes. Number 1. Schedule a reoccurring daily appointment with you and only you. This must happen daily. I like the mornings, but I'll leave that totally up to you and your schedule. Number 2, pick a place where you can silence the noises of life. No TVs, cell phones, iPads, or music, unless it's the meditation, thought-provoking music that stimulates the brain. Number three, this appointment needs to be a minimum of 15 minutes per day. Quality is better than quantity, and consistency is critical. Number four, take the following items to the appointment: a pen, a pad, and you. For the first 30 days, please only bring a pen and a pad. No iPads, Surface Books, or note sections on the phones. They will become more of a distraction than they are of assistance. I don't want to know what Facebook and Twitter thinks. We are after your thoughts. What's going on in your brain? Number five, listen to your listener, your thoughts. What conversations are you having with yourself? Who's winning in the arena of your thought life? The seed you feed determines the harvest you receive. If you don't have my bookwork on the DGCP method for winners, I recommend you get a copy. In the final section, I walk through 31 thought starters for the day. I give you a quote and leave you some lines to journal. It's a great guide to begin practicing this principle. Number six, the purpose of this appointment is to begin thinking about the outcomes, goals, dreams, and desires that lie within and what you would like to see manifested in your life. At Assist You to Win, we call this defining what a win looks like for you. Without a scoreboard, how do you set targets? How do you know what to aim for? How do you know when to praise progress or to make tweaks and adjustments? Your dominant thought should and will become your dream. In the beginning, you will need to bring a scratch pad as well. You will have things bombard your brain that you must jot down so you don't forget and return to the assignment of thinking what you're thinking about. Number eight. The more you do this exercise, the better you will become. This is training and conditioning your mind. Soon you'll be able to do this on the fly. But for now, let's stick to our daily 15-minute appointment. Number nine, when we end each session by summarizing in our journal our thoughts and completing our affirmations for our life. Number 10, we create the future we want by our thoughts and words, followed by massive, immediate, and imperfect action. I took the time to be detailed here because of the importance of forming and framing this dominant thought. Without it, you're merely existing, and with it, you're an unstoppable force of nature. Without it, your best will only be mediocre, and with it, the best version of you continues to evolve. Without it, the limits of your life have already been set, and with it, you are unlimited in your ability and availability. This method of movement is all about increasing and stretching our capacity. Our capacity must continue to increase in order for us to obtain the results of our opportunity. Opportunity always is greater than our capacity. Our dominant thoughts become the magnet that is known as the law of attraction. I'm asking you to attract your dominant thought by subtracting all other thoughts. Winning your best life. I think by now you understand how important I believe this chapter is. So why did I put it in the leadership book? Understand that in order to lead well, you must have a work ethic that is fueled by something internal, not external. So what does this really look like in the life of a leader? Chapter 8.